Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hume, A Very Short Introduction, by James A. Harris, narrated by Julian Elfer. Introduction. In a poll conducted by the BBC in 2005, David Hume was voted the second greatest philosopher of all time. He won more votes than Wittgenstein, Nietzsche, Plato and Kant, and was beaten only by Karl Marx. Other polls have singled him out as the philosopher of the past with whom present-day philosophers most identify, and as one of the most influential Scots of the past 1,000 years. This book provides a brief but comprehensive introduction to his thought. Hume was born in 1711 and died in 1776. He was a contemporary and friend of Adam Smith, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, and Benjamin Franklin. He was a central figure in what we now call the European Enlightenment. He was deeply interested in the ancient world, but he also believed that the world he lived in was fundamentally different from ancient Athens and Rome, and he sought to fashion a philosophy that was suitable to modern conditions. This was to be a philosophy that was answerable to the facts of ordinary human experience, that was skeptical of claims made by authority and tradition, that had made its peace with the passions and sentiments. Unusually for his time, Hume believed that it was obvious that the modern world was superior to the ancient, if not always in its art and culture, then certainly in the quality of the lives lived by ordinary human beings. There had, he thought, been undeniable progress in science and government. Thanks largely to the rise of international commerce, people were living freer and happier lives than had ever been possible before. Philosophy, he thought, had a role to play in understanding this process of improvement, and in identifying possible threats to it. Hume's works are now a staple of university philosophy courses worldwide and are the subject of a major academic industry. But Hume himself was never a university professor. He was instead what we might now call a public intellectual and wrote for a wide audience of non-specialists, an audience that included women as well as men. In the 18th century, philosophy was often not so much a distinct subject matter as a particular style of thought, impartial and objective, precise and backed by evidence. It was an age of philosophical religion and philosophical politics, and also of philosophical chemistry and philosophical geology. Hume believed that philosophy defined in this way was vitally important as a means of moderating political, religious, and cultural factionalism. His works, taken as a whole, can be thought of as a rebuke to the idea that philosophy must be unworldly and disengaged from the concerns of everyday life. They challenge us to think again about what philosophy might have to offer the world outside the walls of the academy. In 18th century Britain, those who contributed to intellectual debate tended to be members of the professions. If not university professors, they were church ministers or lawyers or physicians. Like another great contemporary, Samuel Johnson, Hume cultivated a wholly new kind of literary identity, that of the independent man of letters who made his living from his writings alone and who wrote as his own man, free of obligations either to a patron or to a publisher. Across the Channel, Voltaire had shown what it was possible for a man of letters to achieve in the way of fame and wealth, given sufficient talent and self-belief. Voltaire also, in an entry to Diderot and D'Alembert's Encyclopédie, gave the terms gens de lettres a canonical definition. The man of letters was a manifestation of the esprit philosophique of the modern age. He did not aspire towards universal knowledge, yet had the critical and linguistic ability to make any field of study his own. Until recently, the man of learning was kept out of society, secluded in the monastery or university. Now his writings and his conversation were a necessary part of social life, and had contributed to the instruction and polish of the nation. Of all Hume's works, it is his first, a treatise of human nature, that has the most secure place on university reading lists today. But the treatise is anomalous in its sheer difficulty and in the obscurity of its structure and organizing principles. Disappointed by the reception it met with, Hume turned afterwards to the much more popular form of the essay, both as a means of reformatting his theory of human nature and as the medium for his further explorations of morality and of politics. following the ancient examples of Plato and Cicero and the modern examples of Fontenelle and Shaftesbury, he chose the dialogue form for his most profound consideration of the question of what we can know about the first cause of the universe. He also wrote an enormously successful narrative history of England from the Roman invasion to the Glorious Revolution of 1688. All of these texts will be given due attention here. The listener will find an outline of Hume's career as a man of letters woven into the chapters of this short book. But this is not a biography, and for the full story of Hume's life, it will be necessary to look elsewhere. In the first instance, to Ernest Campbell Mosner's classic, The Life of David Hume. Our main concern here is with Hume's ideas. We begin with his revolutionary theory of human nature. We move on to his no less strikingly innovative discussions of morality and of politics, and we end with his skeptical and subversive philosophy of religion. Chapter 1. Human Nature. David Hume's first published work, A Treatise of Human Nature, originally came in two parts, one on the understanding and the other on the passions. These subjects, Hume told the reader, make a complete chain of reasoning by themselves. The chain of reasoning concerned a question as old as philosophy itself, the question of the relationship between the rational and the emotional elements of human nature. That relationship had often been depicted in terms of antagonism and combat. Individual happiness and social harmony depended, philosophers had often claimed, on reason winning the battle. In the treatise, Hume argued that the whole idea of human nature as site of conflict between reason and passion was a mistake. Properly understood, reason was not a faculty of mind entirely different and distinct in kind from the passions. Reasoning was often, in fact, nothing but a species of sensation, a matter merely of following our taste and sentiment. But this was nothing to worry about because, taken as a whole, the passions were able to organize and regulate themselves. It is not impossible that this highly unorthodox conception of the fundamental structure of human nature had its source in Hume's own experience of the implausibility of the traditional account of the reason-passion relationship. A letter to a physician. Early in September 1729, when he was 18 and still living in the house he had grown up in, Hume suddenly became a mystery to himself. For 4 years, since he had left college at Edinburgh, he had been engaged in a strenuous and solitary course of study and reflection, with the aim of eventually making his way in the world as a scholar and philosopher. He had worked hard, to the exclusion of almost everything else in life, but he had been happy. Now, though, all his ardour seemed to have deserted him. Suddenly, he had no appetite for learning. He felt fine when he put his books to one side, and this made him sure that there was nothing really wrong with him. He was being lazy. He simply needed to work harder. Months passed, and he became aware of physical symptoms indicating that there was more to his condition than mere laziness. He followed the advice of his doctor, took the prescribed medicines, and did more exercise. That helped. He recovered some of his energy and put on a lot of weight. But in the spring of 1734, 4.5 years later, something was still wrong. When he returned to reading and writing, he continued to be dogged by an inability to concentrate. He worried that he would never be able to realize his ambitions. He worried that somehow he had damaged himself with the intensity of his application to his studies. Unable to understand what he was going through, Hume wrote, without revealing his name, to one of the most famous doctors of the day, asking whether his case was a common one, whether he could hope to recover, how long it would take, and how complete a recovery would be. Hume's endeavours in his teenage years had not been purely speculative. He described to the celebrity physician how he had taken the moral philosophy of ancient Greece and Rome so seriously that he had tried to follow the rigorous mental exercises recommended by writers like Cicero, Seneca, and Plutarch. His goal had been to improve his temper and will as much as his reason and understanding. Young though he was, he had tried to think himself into the frame of mind of the sage who was not bothered by the prospect of death, or poverty, or shame, or pain, or any of the other calamities of life. In retrospect, however, he realized that there had been something not only pointless, but also harmful in this kind of philosophical regimen. He had not been living an active life, he had been by himself most of the time, and had had, in reality, no reason to fear any of the harms he was steeling himself against. The whole business had been an immense waste of mental energy, and the fact that it had also made him physically ill forced Hume to ask himself if there might not be something fundamentally misconceived in the philosophy according to which he had been trying to live. The moral philosophy of the ancient world, Hume wrote in his letter, had proceeded on the basis of a set of unexamined assumptions about human nature and about how human beings, possessed of such a nature, ought to go about making themselves happy. Stoic philosophers such as Cicero, Seneca, and Plutarch took it that human beings were most themselves when they were most rational, and that the highest happiness lay in mastering the emotions that got in the way of seeing the world from a properly rational point of view. Hume now found himself doubtful as to whether this really was the truth about how human beings ought to conduct themselves. Life should, of course, be lived in accord with nature. Human nature was the proper point of departure for moral philosophy, and for every other kind of philosophy too. But first it needed to be determined what human nature actually was. Like many others in Europe at the time, Hume believed that a new era in natural philosophy, what we now call natural science, had been announced by Francis Bacon at the beginning of the 17th century. The idea of a fresh start in our knowledge of the natural world had then been made a reality by the work of men such as William Harvey, Robert Boyle, and especially Isaac Newton. Through rigorous application of a method grounded in experience and observation, the modern natural philosophers had shown how completely worthless almost all the science of the ancient world was. There had been some experimental work done on human nature already, and in the treatise, Hume would acknowledge, in particular, groundbreaking contributions by British philosophers such as John Locke, the 3rd Earl of Shaftesbury, Bernard Mandeville, Francis Hutcheson, and Joseph Butler. What he imagined to himself, though, was a comprehensive, systematic analysis of human nature, comparable in its ambition to Newton's great work, The Principles of Natural Philosophy. Soon after Hume wrote his letter about his illness and his new intellectual ambition, he left Scotland for the first time. He travelled first to Bristol, where in the employ of a sugar merchant, he experimented briefly and apparently unsuccessfully with an active life not devoted to letters and learning. He then crossed the Channel to France. Having spent time in Paris and Reims, he settled in the small town of La Flèche in Anjou. He seems to have chosen it because it was a cheap place to live, and perhaps because of Scottish connections, rather than because it was where Descartes had gone to college. He would spend 3 years there working on a theory of human nature that would, so he thought, affect a revolution in philosophy. Mental anatomy. As Hume understood it, the business of the scientist of human nature was, in the first instance, quite different from that of the moralist who had advice for human beings about how they should live their lives. The moralist could be compared to a painter whose aim was graceful and engaging depictions of the life of virtue intended to help people make virtue, not vice, their goal. The kind of work that Hume thought needed to be done, on the other hand, could be compared to that of an anatomist, who began by peeling back the skin and flesh, and whose concern was internal bodily parts that, in themselves, might be hideous to handle and examine. The anatomist's job was not to make the insides of the human body seem beautiful, it was simply to describe the body as it actually was. Similarly, the philosopher of human nature needed to describe what he found in an entirely neutral and objective manner, without making evaluative judgments of any kind. Hume probably took the image of philosophy as anatomy from Mandeville, who, in the fable of the bees, had compared they that examine into the nature of man, abstract from art and education, to those that study the anatomy of dead carcasses. Mandeville had also claimed that what such mental anatomy showed was that man's vilest and most hateful qualities are the most necessary accomplishments to fit him for the largest, and according to the world, the happiest and most flourishing societies. It may have been that Hume had developed his early enthusiasm for ancient moral philosophy in the company of Shaftesbury's major work, Characteristics of Men, Manners, Opinions, Times. There he would have found an essentially stoic moral philosophy updated in accord with the literary and aesthetic sensibility of the modern world. Shaftesbury presented the reader with a variety of strategies for self-discovery and for the cultivation of an independence of mind that would provide protection from bodily and worldly evils. The way Hume describes his youthful ambitions to the unnamed doctor makes him sound like one of the many who came under Shaftesbury's influence in the early 18th century. But when he lost his faith in this kind of philosophy, he would have found a kindred spirit in Mandeville, according to whom Shaftesbury was the prime example of a philosopher who thought only of what he wanted himself to be like and had no awareness at all of his actual nature. One of the greatest reasons why so few people understand themselves, Mandeville proclaimed, is that most writers are always teaching men what they should be and hardly ever trouble their heads with telling them what they really are. Shaftesbury's notions of human nature were a compliment to humankind. What a pity it was that they were not true. The anatomy of human nature, according to Mandeville, revealed that each human being's mind is, in essence, a compound of various passions, and that these passions control people whether they want them to or not. To look beneath outward appearances is to see that, in their psychology as in their physiology, human beings are not very different from the rest of the animal kingdom. The fact that human beings, unlike animals, live in large political and commercial societies can be explained without recourse to the supposition of any uniquely human capacities. Hume, too, believed that an anatomical approach to human nature revealed fundamental similarities between human beings and animals. The major defect of the systems of the mind developed by philosophers was, he thought, that they tended to suppose that the concerns and aptitudes of philosophers provide insight into human nature as such. To focus on the similarities between human minds and animal minds was a salutary corrective to the distortions that such a supposition introduced into the science of human nature. Another key influence on Hume's study of human nature was Locke's Essay Concerning Human Understanding. Like Locke, Hume imagined that in the beginning, at the time of our birth, the mind is a blank sheet, completely empty of ideas, waiting to be filled by the results of sensory contact with the outside world. Of course, there are basic principles of mental functioning which inform how the mind operates on the inputs from the senses. But all of our notions and beliefs, and all but the most elementary of our desires, are the product of experience. To make sense of ourselves, then, it was necessary to try to reconstruct how mental life, as we know it, might have developed by way of the accumulation of, and interaction between, an almost infinite number of individual perceptions and sensations. It was pointless, however, to involve actual physiology in the attempt to discover order in the apparent chaos of the inner life. To do that was inevitably to get caught up in fraught debates about the relation between mind and body, which had dogged the philosophy of the 17th century, and which Locke's purely experience-based method enabled his followers to put to one side. Locke had transformed the study of the mind and its powers by sticking resolutely to that method, particularly insofar as he had identified the limits of what the understanding enables us to understand. Hume began his anatomy of human nature with further examination of the understanding and with the apparent discovery that it is even less reliable than Locke had imagined. The understanding. One of the earliest of Hume's surviving letters tells us that at the same time that he was planning a new anatomical science of human nature, he was reading the French skeptic Pierre Bayle. In a devastating critique of the moral casuistry of mainstream French Catholic culture, Bayle had revived styles of argument characteristic of ancient Pyrrhonism, a school of extreme skepticism intent on showing that no proposition can be proved any more likely to be true than its negation. His goal had been to undermine the whole idea of a rational Christianity, such as could be taught in schools and seminaries, and to show that the foundation of true religion had to be a faith given directly to human beings by God himself. Confidence in reason, in other words, was completely unjustified. Such confidence was likely to lead to error and sin. Hume did not share Bayle's religious objectives, but he was deeply impressed by the French philosopher's assault on the pretensions of philosophy. During his time in La Flèche, he would have had access to the library of the college there and could have read widely and deeply in its collection of both ancient and modern skeptical texts. Pyrrhonist themes are woven into many of Hume's writings, nowhere more strikingly than in the theory of the human understanding laid out in Book One of A Treatise of Human Nature, the dramatic culmination of which is a cry of despair in the face of what looked like a choice betwixt a false reason and none at all.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.